As we begin the focus on the actual intertestamental period, everything starts with the Greeks. And the story of the Greeks and the influence and really interaction with Israel begins with Philip of Macedon. The Macedonians were viewed by the Greeks as uncouth, unsophisticated, unethical, politically inept, and militarily weak. There was tension and competition between the Greeks and the Macedonians. The Macedonians came from northern Greece, a smaller kingdom in that period. Ben Witherington says Philip and Alexander suffered from a cultural inferiority complex, and they were determined to prove the Greeks wrong at every point of their characterization of Macedonians. Witherington continues and says Alexander identified himself with Achilles, the great Greek hero, who was said to be an ancestor of his mother. On his father's side, the lineage was traced back to Heracles, whom we call Hercules. And so he traces his lineage to nobility. Now, Alexander the Great's father is Philip II of Macedon, and he lived from 382 to 336 BC. He began his reign, Philip that is, at the age of 21, and he was a very innovative military general. He conquered through military innovation and uniqueness. In 338 BC, he defeated Thebes and Athens, and he began to introduce new ideas into the military warfare, specifically a career military man, which demanded discipline. It demanded a success that he expected of all of his soldiers. So he introduced the career military service as an idea at that time period. He hired mercenaries as well. 50% of his army was outside of Macedon. And he's the one who adopted the Greek phalanx and then perfected it. It was one of the most effective ways to fight in that time period. It's an enduring formation of the soldiers, the Greek phalanx, that is. That was traced back to Sumeria, about 2500 BC, made its way through Egypt, and finally appears in Greek literature in Homer, about 8th century BC. Even though it's generally been associated with the Greeks, but that's really the history of the phalanx. And the idea comes from finger. It's oriented in such a direction, the army itself, that it represents almost like a finger. And so the formation itself was a close rank, a dense group of warriors standing together with long spears at the front and interlocking shields. The idea of this individual, he had his own weapons. He had a 7 or 8 foot long spear known as the doru, and he had a shield and a breastplate, helmet, and greave. So this was a typical soldier in that time period. The Greek hoplite would have been the terminology. There was no official training necessarily for Greek hoplite, so it was the responsibility of the individual commander to prepare the soldier for battle and to train them how to fight in unity. So Philip of Macedon changed and took all these ideas and perfected them, improved them as he trained the phalanx formation of the soldiers, introducing the idea of a professional soldier to Macedonia. He actually began to provide the warriors training, a smaller shield, a long spear, and a sarissa, which is a sword that was used in various ways. He used siege engines, archers, cavalry, and they all began to work in sync under his military direction. So once the Greeks sensed the weakness of the Medo-Persian Empire in around the time of Cyrus II, they saw the weakness of that empire and they began to move in. And so under Philip's reign, and then subsequently under Alexander's reign, the Macedonians really through that influence caused the collapse of the Medo-Persian Empire. Now, as we get towards the end of Philip of Macedon's era, it was the summer of 336 BC. He was at home in Macedonia. He was a successful general up to this point, recognized so. The town of Philippi is named after him. He had scars of a military man. In fact, he had a noticeable missing eye that sometimes is represented with a patch in later history. And in that summer, sometime in 336 BC, but getting close into the fall, his assassination took place. Now, there's still not certainty in exactly who and why Philip of Macedon was assassinated, but various theories have been offered. One of them is that perhaps because Philip of Macedon had just divorced Olympias, who was the mother of Alexander, and married the woman Eurydice, Olympias thought that perhaps Philip would not allow Alexander to be the successor. And so some have attributed the plot to Alexander's mother, Olympias, as she was concerned for his future. And there's still not certainty about this at all, but there was a celebration. And the celebration at this point in his home was to celebrate his upcoming invasion of Asia and also to focus on his previous successes in military. And so what happened is, in order to spend time with the people as part of the celebration, he left his bodyguards behind, told them all to leave, except there was one by the name of Pausanias who disobeyed the orders. And seemingly, he had a dagger that was hidden, and he plunged it into Philip, killing him. Now, recent excavations indicate, in excavations of a tomb that was found in 1977-78 in Virginia, Greece, indicate that there were some wounds that seem to indicate that this is probably Philip II of Macedonia, because he suffered a leg wound, and this skeleton that has been discovered indicates that there is some kind of a wound in the leg. And the conclusion is that it seems that this is the body of Philip of Macedon II. Now, upon his assassination, Alexander the Great becomes the successor, and he becomes the king. This is all in 336 BC. And at that point, we focus our attention on Alexander because he's the one who's actually going to bring in Hellenism and the Greek ideas into ancient Israel. Alexander himself was tutored by Aristotle and Leonidas. And what was said of them is that they invested strong disciplinary ideas into Alexander. They put a lot of emphasis on physical training and endurance. Alexander, Ben Withington writes, had a remarkable memory. He seldom forgot a slight and certainly never forgave one. There's a story that Withington writes about Alexander when Leonidas chastised Alexander when he was still a boy for throwing too much incense into the sacrificial fire and sarcastically suggests that he could do so extravagantly only after he conquers the spice-bearing regions of the world. Well, the story goes that Alexander answers his tutor many, many years later when he conquers Gaza and sends Leonidas 18 tons of incense and spices. To what degree this is exaggerated, we don't know. But the idea is that he listened and he was invested into by some of the most famous Greeks who taught him. Aristotle taught Alexander a variety of subjects: medicine, biology, geometry, astronomy, and rhetoric, specifically in the art of arguing. That is what we get from Ben Witherington as well, who continues that for 3 years, Alexander studied with Aristotle. He taught him superiority of the Greek language and culture to all forms, other forms of human expression. So the idea that Hellenism and the Greek way of life is superior to everybody else was given to him and introduced to him by Aristotle. The first time that we have the mention of the title great given to him is in Plautus's Mustalaria. It's a play, and it compares the actors to Alexander the Great. This is 2nd century BC. So in other words, we don't really have evidence that he was called the Great in his own lifetime. This came a little bit later. But for Alexander, it wasn't so much about conquering the world as continuing the legacy of his father. Alexander was driven by this ideal that Aristotle and Leonidas and his father gave to him, that we need to spread the Greek way of life because it is the superior way of life. Therefore, everybody that you encounter and conquer has to be Hellenized. And Hellenization refers to Alexander's plan to give the world one language, one culture, one way of life. A single language, a single culture, and a single approach to life. Hellenization comes from the Greek word Hellenes, or Hellenizo is the verb, and it's the idea of the Greeks. And so they believed that they surpassed other cultures. And so in order to improve the world, everybody had to speak Greek. Of course, this is an era of arrogance that was passed on by these Greeks to other nations. So in about 400s BC, in the middle of that era, the focus of life becomes man. Greeks were humanists. Man is the total sum of all that is valuable in the universe. Sophist Protagoras says the measure of all things is man. And so the ideals associated with that are health, beauty, and wealth. And so they had this uncompromisingly unique high regard for the male physique. They valued man. The physical, the mind, the artistic abilities, the literary abilities of humanity, and the academic aptitude of mankind. The reason that we have so much immorality that's discussed in Greek writings is because they imitated the writings and what was valuable to the Greeks based on the gods. And so their gods, it was kind of a symbiotic relationship. The gods reflected man, and man reflected the gods in that sense. Marriage was typically understood to be for procreation. Homosexuality was for pleasure. The Roman elites later would adopt the same ideals and advance them. And so you have the same kind of weaknesses and strengths that reflect in humanity would be reflected in their gods. The Olympic Games come to us from 776 BC, 776 BC, in the city of Olympia in Greece. And so they introduce athletic contests to us as well. So by the time Alexander the Great comes onto the scene, the focus becomes not simply the external, that's still a part of it, but also internal, education, law, mathematics, medicine, astronomy. All this is focused on individualism and the importance of that. And so now the focus shifts from the Greek noble birth to the Greek culture becoming the center of Hellenization. And so all the foreign conquests that we see happening with Alexander the Great, they intend to spread this kind of understanding of humanity and humanism and the Greek culture, providing one currency, the silver coins, one language, Koine Greek, based on Attic Greek, education, the spread of the Greek deities, the Greek gods, the Greek cults. And so other nations then begin to call their own gods by Greek names as well. And the philosophy that the Greeks introduced was sophism, stoicism, that we gained from ancient Greek ideas. Polis becomes the framework for the existence of a village, of a countryside, and now everything focuses more into kind of city life. So Ferguson writes about the Greeks in this way: the breaking of traditional patterns of inherited conduct in the enlarged world of the Hellenistic age threw people back upon themselves and gave opportunity for individual expression. Chosen things became more important than inherited things. Individualism comes into the picture with all of this Greek influence in antiquity. And Alexander was committed to spreading these ideas globally. His father did a good job setting him up and giving him this empire. He expanded it and conquered more. But now he now had to focus on spreading the ideals all the way to the east. And so what we see happening is Alexander the Great's empire that his father conquered. This is the image of the Persian Empire, the blue. But then you see the expansion of it by Alexander in the coming, in his time period. Okay. So when you consider the success of Alexander, you see that he spreads the empire far east. Just to go back to the previous picture, you can see where it was. And now the expansion far east as well. He was a military genius, like his father. And he went, built Alexandria in 331 BC. Later, we would study that it becomes a very important center of early Christianity. But it had also become one of those learned cities in the ancient world. One of the largest libraries in the world was housed in Alexandria. Josephus, the Jewish historian, writes in his Antiquities that when Alexander entered Judea, the high priest greeted him. And Alexander told him that he saw him in a dream, and that God told him that he would conquer the Persian Empire. And it seems that the reference comes from Daniel chapter 7, when we want to reconcile exactly what Josephus is talking about. In Daniel chapter 7, verse 6, this is the dream probably that this high priest allegedly refers to. After I kept looking, and behold, another one, like a leopard, which had on its back four wings of a bird, the beast also had four heads, and domination was given to it. And then if you go back to chapter 2 in Daniel, we also see a statement made about this. And after you, there will arise another kingdom inferior to you, and a third kingdom of bronze, which will rule the earth. So the bronze kingdom represents the four-winged creature. And this high priest, when he meets Alexander the Great, as he makes his way into ancient Israel, he greets him and says, you are the fulfillment of this prophecy in Daniel 2 and in Daniel 7. And I'd like to read for us this section from Josephus, giving us an insight into a primary source about this event. So this comes from Josephus' Antiquities, when Alexander meets the high priest in Judea, and it's in Josephus' Antiquities, chapter 11, section 326. We'll begin in 321, just for context. But Sanballat, though he had now gotten a proper opportunity to make his attempt, so he renounced Darius, and taking with him 7,000 of his own subjects, he came to Alexander, and finding him beginning the siege of Tyre, he said to him that he delivered up to him these men who came out of a place under his dominion, and gladly accept for the Lord instead of Darius. So when Alexander had received him kindly, Sanballat thereupon took courage and spoke to him about his present affair. He told him that he had a son-in-law, Manasseh, who was the brother of the high priest, Judah, and that there were many others of his own nation now with him that were desirous to have a temple in the palaces subjected to him. It would be the king's advantage to have the strength of the Jews divided into two parts, lest when the nation is of one mind and united upon any attempt for innovation, it prove troublesome to kings, as it had formerly proved to the kings of Assyria. Whereupon Alexander gave Sanballat leave to do so, who used the utmost diligence and built the temple and made Manasseh the priest, and deemed it a great reward that his daughter's children should have the dignity. But when the 7 months of the siege of Tyre were over and the 2 months of the siege of Gaza, Sanballat died. Now Alexander, when he had taken Gaza, made haste to go to Jerusalem. And Judah the high priest, when he had heard that, was in agony and under terror, as not knowing how he should meet the Macedonians, since the king was displeased at his foregoing disobedience. He therefore ordained that the people should make supplication and should join with him in offering sacrifices to God, whom he besought to protect that nation and to deliver them from the perils that were coming upon him. Whereupon God warned him in a dream, which came upon him after he had offered sacrifice, that he should take courage and adorn the city and open the gates, that the rest appear in white garments, that he and the priests should meet the king in the habits proper to their order, without the dread of any ill consequences, for the providence of God would prevent. Upon which, when he rose from his sleep, he greatly rejoiced and declared to all the warning him he had received from God, according to which dream he acted entirely, and so waited for the coming of the king. And when he understood that he was not far from the city, he went out in a procession with the priests and the multitude of the citizens. The procession was venerable, and the manner of it different from that of other nations. It reached to a place called Safa, which name translated into Greek signifies a prospect, for you have thence a prospect both of Jerusalem and of the temple. And when the Phoenicians and the Chaldeans that followed him, though they should have liberty to plunder the city and torment the high priest to death, which the king's displeasure fairly promised them, the very reverse of it happened. For Alexander, when he saw the multitude at a distance in white garments, while the priests stood clothed with fine linen, and the high priest in purple and scarlet clothing, with his mitre and his head having the golden plate on which the name of God was engraved, he approached by himself and adored that name, and the first saluted the high priest. The Jews also did all together, with one voice salute Alexander, and encompass him about, whereupon the kings of Syria and the rest were surprised at what Alexander had done, and supposed him disordered in his mind. However, Parmenio alone went up to him and asked him how it came to pass that when all others adored him, he should adore the high priest of the Jews. To whom he replied, I did not adore him, but that God, who has honored him with that high priesthood. For I saw this very person in a dream, in this very habit, when I was at Dios in Macedonia, who, when I was considering with myself how I might obtain the dominion of Asia, exhorted me to make no delay, but boldly to pass over the sea here, for that he would conduct my army and would give me the dominion over the Persians. Whence it is that having seen no other in that habit, and now seeing this person in it, and remembering that vision and the exhortation which I had in my dream, I believe that I bring this army under the divine conduct, and shall therewith conquer Darius, and destroy the power of the Persians, and that all things will succeed according to what is in my own mind. When he said this to Parmenio, and had given the high priest his right hand, the priests ran along by him, and he came into a city, and when he went up into the temple, he offered sacrifice to God, according to the high priest's direction, and magnificently treated both the high priest and priests. And when he took the book of Daniel that was showed him, wherein Daniel declared that one of the Greeks should destroy the empire of the Persians, he supposed he himself was the person intended. And as he was then glad, he dismissed the multitude for the present. But the next day he called them to him and bade them ask what favors they pleased of him. Whereupon the high priest desired that they may enjoy the laws of their forefathers, and might pay no tribute on the seventh year. He granted all they desired. And when they entreated him that he would permit the Jews in Babylon and Media to enjoy their own laws also, he willingly promised to do hereafter what they desired. And when he said to the multitude that if any of them would enlist themselves in his army in this condition, that they should continue under the law of their forefathers and live according to them, he was willing to take them with him. Many were ready to accompany him in the wars. So, as Alexander intersects with ancient Israel for the very first time, the story is that the high priest with other priests meet him, and instead of destroying and conquering, he welcomes, he worships, apparently offers a sacrifice, and a peaceful treaty is made. That he would allow the ancient Jewish people to live in peace as long as they would offer some soldiers to him, and as long as they would live in peace. And he having extended that promise outside of Jerusalem, we see into Babylon and into Media. And so it seems that perhaps Josephus is leaning on Daniel chapter 7 and Daniel chapter 2 when he talks about this encounter. This is unique. If you know Greek history, most of the time the conquest takes place in destruction. Whereas here, there's a peaceful submission to Alexander the Great's entrance into Jerusalem. So Alexander, his policy was to annihilate, and yet here's a peaceful surrender. So from this point forward, this is about 332 BC, as you look at his story as it gets towards the end of his life, he has a few battles that ultimately allow him to be victorious. In 334, for example, there's a battle of Granicus in Asia Minor. In 333 BC, the battle of Issus. In 331 BC, the battle of Arbela. And this is how he completes the conquest of the Medo-Persian Empire. Now, as you see him finishing this, in the year 333 BC, the battle of Issus is described in Daniel chapter 8, verse 7. It says, I saw him come beside the ram, and he was enraged at him, and he struck the ram and shattered his two horns, and the ram had no strength to withstand him. So he hurled him to the ground and trampled him, and there was none to rescue the ram from his power. So this is the conquest of Issus in 333. In 331 BC, the conquest of Gaugamela, the Battle of Gaugamela, the Persians are outnumbering the Greeks. Darius III, or Darius the Great, flees. Two satraps form a coup against him, and they finally kill him. And so Bessus, one of the satraps, finally kills him. And Alexander the Great throws a huge party for him and marries Darius' daughter, Statera, a little bit later in Susa. Once he gains control of the territories that belong to the Medo-Persian Empire, the Babylonian Empire, and the Assyrian Empire, he continues to go east. And historians surmise that he would have gotten as far as China if his army had not gotten restless after thousands of miles of campaigns and warfare. So they began to rebel against him. They wanted to go home. And as he arrives back in Babylon, a severe fever hit Alexander the Great. And we find out that some, at the age of 32 years of age, he dies after this illness hits him without leaving an heir. And so it seems that while he was a great warrior and a great individual in leading the military campaigns, he did not think about succession. And so once he dies, the 20 generals under him fight for influence and fight for power. 20 rulers arise to do so. And from the year 323 until 301 BC, those 20 years are marked by instability. Until finally, four generals emerge as the most powerful, the most influential, and they effectively carve out portions of Alexander's empire for themselves. And if you look at the screen, you see the division of the empires into the colors green, purple, yellow, and orange. And those are that area is what will ultimately be called as the era of the Diadochi, his successors. That's the meaning of the word Diadochi. And it's his heirs that have divided the empire after him. Now, as we think about his interaction with Jerusalem, it was a peaceful transition. In Samaria, something different happened when he interacted with them. The Samaritans resisted Alexander, so he destroyed Samaria and forced Hellenization upon them and then reinstituted Samaria as a Greek colony. And so Samaria then becomes, during the period of Alexander the Great, the center of Hellenism, Greek culture, theater, art, philosophy, language, religion. And this is just north of Jerusalem. So now you begin to understand how the tensions that are described in the Gospels, in John chapter 4, for example, and the Synoptic Gospels as well, how that didn't start with Jesus. It goes all the way back 300 years prior in how Alexander dealt with Samaria, forcing Hellenization, and they become fully immersed in that, whereas Jerusalem was a little bit more lax. And therefore, there was constant tension because one was fully Hellenized and the other ones resisted Hellenization. So it becomes the center of Hellenism in that period. The Samaritan cities take on Greek names, Greek law. And so many people in that period who were of Jewish descent, they would actually ultimately lose their understanding of Hebrew. Well, back to the fall of Alexander's empire. It gets divided into four sections. Ptolemies, which is Egypt. The Seleucids, that's Syria. Lysimachus, he was the general, that's Asia Minor, it's Turkey. And Cassander, that's Macedonia and Greece. Those are the four individuals who end up being the successors to the great Alexander, Alexander the Great. Now, the connection to biblical history and ancient Israel is such that from the fall of Alexander the Great until 301 BC, those wars finally create the four successors. But from that time period, all the way until about 198 BC, let's just call it 200 BC, there are constant wars between two of those individuals. And that is Egypt and Syria, or the Seleucids and Ptolemies. And the Seleucids are north of Israel. The Ptolemies, or Egypt, is south of Israel. And they're constantly battling one another. And Israel is caught in the middle. And that 130-year period, 320 to about 200 BC, is what constantly creates conflict and tension for ancient Israel, because these two generals and their successors are at odds with one another. Well, in the year 198 BC, this all kind of comes to an end, and the Seleucids come into power, and that begins to slowly usher in the Hasmonean dynasty. And so this takes us into the next section as we go from the Greek introduction, the introduction of Hellenism and the Greek way of life into ancient Israel because of Philip of Macedon and then later his son Alexander the Great. And as he dies, then his successors, specifically the Ptolemies and the Seleucids, take on this responsibility to continue to spread Hellenism into their areas, one of which will be ancient Israel. So we're going to pause here. And this takes us into the next section, talking about the Hasmonean dynasty.